we might begin. So I want to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the unceded land on which we're meeting this evening, the Wurundjeri and Woiwurrung people. I pay respect to elders past and present and acknowledge how much we all have to learn from Indigenous knowledges and cultures. I want briefly to note the sadness and distress felt by many in the University Indigenous community following the referendum. Our Dean, Russell Goulburn, wrote to us on Monday saying, after the polarised campaign and the referendum result itself, we need to rediscover in our society in general and in our political system in particular the fundamental values of decency, fairness, generosity and humility. And I think that's a sentiment that many of us will share. I was just telling Kate, amidst all of that, I spent part of the weekend reading Kate Fullagar's wonderful new book on Bennelong and Philip. Her reflections on the tone and the consequences of the European Enlightenment for peoples outside of Europe, combined with the flow of news about a different unresolved settler colonial situation in Israel and Palestine, made it a pretty somber weekend. I want briefly, this is the Greg Denning Memorial Lecture. It's something we've held every year, I think for, I don't know how long, more than a decade. Greg Denning was a professor of history here from 1971 to 1990. I've put up there a very skeleton biography. He did honours in history here, graduating in 1958, went on to an MA in Pacific prehistory, supervised by John Mulvaney, who is teaching Pacific prehistory here before moving to the ANU. Greg went on to a PhD in anthropology at Harvard, where he wrote a dissertation on the Marquesas Islands, which became the book on the left, Islands and Beaches, Discourses on a Silent Land. He held positions at the University of Hawaii, Queensland, for a bit longer at La Trobe University from 1969, but as I said, was professor here, 71 to 1990. And I just note here, in relationship to the subject matter tonight, was involved in setting up the first standalone Indigenous history subject here at Melbourne in 1990 with a teaching team that included Lisa Belair, Pat Grimshaw, Stuart McIntyre and Patrick Wolfe. Greg was known for his scholarship in Pacific history and culture contact, the idea of a marriage of history and anthropology, of trying to write that contact history from both sides of the beach. He came here in the early 1970s very self-conscious about history as a discipline. His inaugural address given to the Association for the Advancement of Science, I've forgotten the acronym, History as a Social System, there was a series of really interesting reflections, not on interdisciplinarity, which he didn't especially approve, but thinking self-consciousness about the relationships between history and the social sciences. I've created a word cloud there of that article, and you get a sense of the way in which talking about disciplines and the blinkers that they imposed was a big part of what he was on about at that time. He created a new subject called Social and Reflective History. I took it in the same year as Tom Griffiths, who recalled, won't read the quote, but I've got it up there, requiring students to write an ethnography of some aspect of their own society, developing a sort of anthropological self-consciousness about history. I personally had the great good fortune to be employed by Greg for a whole year as his research assistant on this project here. You can see his handwritten account that I found in the archives on history and the symbol sciences. And we did a whole lot of things that year. It didn't end up as a book, but it informed a number of the things that he wrote subsequently. In retirement from Melbourne, he associated himself with ANU and ran a series of now legendary challenges to perform workshops for PhD students, mainly at the ANU, occasionally down here. And his later writings were often these essay-length reflections on the nature of history. I've just put up there what I think is a very typical quote about the role of imagination in history, something he constantly advocated. The challenge to perform was to not be afraid, to dramatize, to make history in more imaginative ways. That's all I'm going to say about Greg. It's a great pleasure, though, to introduce Kate Fullagar, who is going to talk to us tonight about her very new book, Bennelong and Philip. You can see up here the covers of her other books. Kate graduated from ANU with an honours degree in history, MA and PhD at the University of California at Berkeley, postdoctoral fellow at the University of Sydney, 2010 to 2020 at Macquarie, and since 2020, a professor in the Institute for Humanities and Social Sciences at ACU. She's the author of the books you can see up there. I won't go through all of them. The Savage Visit, 2012, the edited collection with Mike McDonald, The Warrior, The Voyager, and The Artist, and now the first of these books, which is in Australian history, that we're going to hear about tonight. As I said, I was reading the book over the weekend. It's absolutely wonderful, and it's a great pleasure to welcome Kate tonight.
Thank you so much. Oh, it is on. Great. I was going to do that for testing for a little while. Great. Thank you so much, David. And I'd like to begin by acknowledging that we are on Wurundjeri Woiwurrung land and on Bunurong land. I'm thankful to be here. I pay my respects on to the elders of those peoples and extend through them my respects to any First Nations people who might be in the room here today. As David intimated, it's been a very tough week in that sphere. So I was beyond delighted when Matthew Champion over there invited me to deliver this year's Greg Denning lecture. In fact, I was so delighted that in my overexcitable way, I started writing the lecture immediately, that is several months ago. However, last week, we at ACU down the road received the final plan from our superiors to disestablish 41 scholars in the humanities and social sciences, and I am among the 41. So I must admit that for a hot minute there, I was thinking I have a full hour with a captive audience. I could tell them all of my feelings about ACU, and there's nothing that you can do about it. And I do appreciate that we have a bit of an ACU phalanx around here, and possibly there's two or three people in the room who would prefer that lecture. But we can have that lecture in a pub maybe some other day. In the end, sense prevailed. So we're going to park that white elephant in the room, in the corner over there, and I'll get back to my original notes, which I started a few months ago. So that lecture began with an acknowledgement that I did not know Greg Denning as well as many people in the room here did, and I'm very aware of that. But I did know him a little bit, and I certainly came to know his writings very deeply. He and they have influenced almost all my historical work of the past 25 years, in ways that I am still discovering today, to be honest. I knew Greg, going to pass this. I knew Greg at three different moments around the turn of the last century, if we can use such a grandiose phrase. And the first time, I just want to go through those three moments, really, those three meetings. The first time I met him, I was about 23 years old. I just graduated with my bachelor's degree from ANU, as David intimated. And I was working for a year as a research assistant in the Centre for Cross-Cultural Research at ANU. Greg was a visiting scholar in that centre. And unhappily for me, though, it was a pretty bad year for me, and I was suffering from a bout of depression, which was pretty much my only such experience of such an affliction. So my response was to go to work every day with my head down, and I didn't really talk to anybody. So I never took the enormous opportunities that I had then to get to know Greg really well, even though he sat in the office directly opposite me. He was waving, I was drowning. And I recall really that we only spoke properly once. And this was when I was really pushed to set up a formal meeting with him by others to discuss my then potential PhD topic. Others in the centre told me that he might know a thing or two about my interests. And in that meeting, I spoke to him about these sort of fledgling interests, which were, I seem to remember I put it, that I was interested in somehow combining Pacific Islander history with British imperial history, specifically in the 18th century. My experience of learning Pacific history as an undergraduate at ANU was, I realise now, a bit quirky, since the ethos then, if people remember the ANU Pacific School's variety of ethoses, but it was then to kind of basically eradicate all mention of Europeans as if they had never invaded. ANU's Pacific School was decolonising its curriculum well ahead of its time, but it was doing so in a rather blunt fashion. And I asked Greg if he thought that perhaps Pacific history did need to account for European imperialism somehow. Could one successfully combine the fields? So plainly, I had not read a single word by Greg at this point. And he was very gracious and didn't mention the fact that most of his work for the last 30 years had been on that precise question, really. Instead, he offered me an idea for a potential PhD thesis. And that was an ethnographic history of Samuel Wallace's voyage to Tahiti in 1767. This was the first European ship to land at the island. Such a topic would combine a history of 18th century Tahiti, an analysis of British high politics in the Enlightenment era, a maritime history, the history of science, the history of diplomacy, the history of masculinity. Really, what was there not to like about this topic? Well, back then, everything, apparently. I dismissed the idea then as ship shit, as my later sister-in-law would call it. But 25 years later, I can confirm that this is actually an excellent idea for a PhD. I was reminded of this a few years later when I was, only a few years back from now, actually, when I was writing this book that David's mentioned, The Warrior, The Voyager, and The Artist. And there are a few pages on Wallace's arrival in Tahiti in this book. But they are crammed pages. They're teeming with big personalities, significant historical stakes, a volatile cultural showdown. And I did remember Greg's suggestion very, very much too late at that point. Anyway, after my chat with Greg, I recovered. I set off the following year to UC Berkeley to start a PhD in history. And in my recovery, I began reading Greg Denning. Everyone in the Berkeley History Department knew of Greg Denning, and most had read, oh, here's me at Berkeley. Most of them had read this 1980 book, Islands and Beaches, about the Marquesas, a different cover that David showed before. This was a little surprising to me that they were so familiar with this book, because I was pretty sure that few of them could point to the Marquesas on a map. But the faculty knew of him because they knew of the so-called Melbourne School, which consisted of what they thought of Greg Denning, Rhys Isaacs, Ingelken Denning, Donna Merrick, and some others. This school and its ethno-historical mode had recently been popularised by their hero, the faculty's hero, Clifford Geertz. Now, the Berkeley faculty's familiarity with one of Greg's books and my now insatiable appetite for all his other books led me to choose Denning as the subject of my final master's assignment. That task was to write an article-length paper on a significant modern historian. My fellow students foolishly chose people who had passed away, Ferdinand Braudel, Mark Bloch, and so on. I not only chose someone alive, but also someone famously generous. I wrote to Greg to explain what I was doing. I also, of course, had to apologise for my behaviour at the centre the previous year. I said I'd been unhappy. I regretted my missed opportunities. I felt stupid for not having known who he was. He replied with a letter that I've kept. "We saw that you were sad," he said, referring to himself and his wife Donna, "but hoped you would get better soon." There followed many emails back and forth. Most of them were practical, me just asking for clarification about a period in his life, him sending me documents. Documents, obviously, that in America I couldn't otherwise access. We also spoke of teaching. I was tutoring for the first time at this point. He told me to let my students see me learning. I said, "Yeah, right, but have you ever been a young Australian trying to command the attention of American teenagers?" He said, "Yes." In the end, I titled my paper, "The Historian as Magical Realist." It was an analysis of what Greg more commonly called ethnohistory. The nub of my argument being, our shared arguments being, that only this approach could capture the timeliness of both the past and the teller, as well as the otherness of bygone cultures, be they Western or non-Western. Or perhaps in other words, the place of the past and its teller in history and the foreignness of every past, as if those pasts were different countries. The third and last time I knew Greg was when I enrolled in one of his challenges to perform workshops. That was at ANU in 2002. I do have some pictures here, some of them you have seen. There's also a picture of his supervisor, Mulvaney, up there. I was still a Berkeley PhD student, but I'd come home for the final stretch. And these 2 weeks for the workshop were spent with him and a large rota of his friends, including Dipesh Chakrabarty, Tom Griffiths, Bill Gamage, Katerina Teoa. They were formative, they were frustrating, they were inspiring, they were irritating, and they were indeed a challenge. I had moved on slightly at this point from my awe of Greg to some critique of his approach, because I was in an American graduate school, and that's one of the most powerful legacies of it. A chief critique of mine then was of his insistence on the value of experimentation, even in that least flexible genre, the doctoral dissertation, the PhD dissertation. Must be nice to be an emeritus, I thought. He no longer had to face, as I did, a university that not only stipulated the font in which a PhD had to be written, but even the brand of paper on which it had to be printed. Greg, though, was unmoved. Not a single one of his students, he said, had ever failed from form alone. Most had discovered more about the past for themselves and for others by moving the needle on what they thought was possible. I never really deeply reconnected with Greg after that. He must have known that I'd completed my dissertation eventually. It was not, in the end, an ethnohistory of Wallace in Tahiti, but it was a history of the various indigenous peoples who visited Britain throughout the 18th century. So it did bring the Pacific and Europe together, but it was not, they were not meeting in my book together on a beach in the Southern Hemisphere, but instead in the taverns and coffee houses of Georgian London. I was upset when Greg died in 2008, though grateful to keep in touch with Donna a few times before her own death. For the rest of this talk, I'd like to speak on three themes in my new book, Bennelong and Philip, which resonate with three of the most important themes for me of Greg's work. And these include the theme of comparative research, the theme of kind of combining fields in the humanities, the theme of ethnohistory, or what I had called back in the day magical realist history, and the theme of writerly experimentation. So my new book. I think many people here in the room know, but perhaps not everyone will know, that Bennelong was a Wongal man of today's Sydney Harbour area. He was born in the mid-1760s, so was in his early 20s then, when he first saw Britain's fleet of convict settlers arrive in Gadigal country in 1788. Arthur Phillip, also on the screen there, was the inaugural governor of the colony that sprang up from 1788. He was around 50 years old when he came to New South Wales, and he stayed as the governor for 5 years. For a brief period, Bennelong and Phillip were the most influential leaders of their respective communities during this critical period of early contact. Bennelong journeyed with Phillip to London when the governor retired. He stayed there for a couple of years. He made it back after 3 years. He comes back in 1795. The men died within 1 year of each other, in 1813 and 1814, respectively. So I'm going to start with the last theme that I mentioned, actually, that of writerly experimentation. And I will go through my three themes, actually, in reverse order, which is apt, because the chief experiment undertaken in Bennelong and Phillip was to unravel their stories from end to beginning. That is, that we open the book in the present and then track back through the men's posthumous reputations through this century, last century, through the 19th century, and then arrive at their respective deaths, right? And then the subsequent chapters then narrate their final years, their time together in London, and the time before that together in Sydney, their difficult meeting in 1789, their younger days, and finally their origins in blood and place. So why did I write it this way? Well, mainly because a back-running method best matched the argument that I wanted to make about these two men, which is that we should reverse, or at least upturn, their commonly dominant images. Despite some revisionist scholarship on Bennelong in the last decade or so, the prevailing, I would say, common image of this man is that of a tragic victim. While Australian popular memory is happy to acknowledge that Bennelong was an important representative of his people for a brief while with the colonists, it also believes that he paid a terrible price for this work, that he ended up drunk, alone, lost between two worlds, rejected by the colonists and by the Eora. I use the word Eora to kind of talk about the dozen or so clans that were nearest to around the Sydney Harbour at this point in time. The ubiquity of Bennelong's name around Sydney and the nation, it's a name that's attached to a key electorate, as many will know, it's attached to a stunning harbour peninsula. It is attached also to more than one hedge fund for some reason. But the ubiquity of that name around Australia is mostly the result of guilty feelings on the part of settlers for Bennelong's apparently miserable later life. Guilt certainly drove the New South Wales government recently to purchase Bennelong's supposed gravesite in Putney in 2018. Now, atonement might well be necessary for a bunch of reasons regarding what colonisation did to the Eora and all other Aboriginal people in this continent. But it's not the most appropriate word for Bennelong. In Bennelong's mind, he already exacted his revenge on Phillip for his initial kidnapping in 1789, when he helped to orchestrate the payback, a revenge on Phillip with a ritual spearing through Phillip's shoulder, and that occurred at Guyame in 1790. After that kind of ritual payback for the initial kind of affront of the kidnapping, Bennelong always behaved as if he was the governor's equal, as if the slate had been wiped clean. And then he acted as his equal in their negotiating endeavours. And I think it's not too far-fetched to say either that Phillip kind of agreed with him for at least the 2 or 3 years that they actively were kind of counterpart diplomats, working together to defuse some of the worst excesses of the fleet's invasion. So I wanted to show in detail that Bennelong did not have a miserable later life. He just had a later life after his episode with Phillip, lived away from the colony. And that was a result of his active decision from around about 1796, mid-1790s, to forsake the politics of the newcomers. What Bennelong was doing in his last 15, 16, 17 years of life, after returning from London, was re-immersing himself back into Eora society. He took up the role of leader, perhaps even elder, and he can be glimpsed in sources that have until now been read to illuminate other things. These sources show a man re-engaging as a key participant in ritual clan battles all around the harbour, and bearing increasing scars on his ever-thinning body. Not because he was falling on hard times, which is how most colonists then interpreted those kind of bodily manifestations, but really because he was rising in Indigenous prominence. The sources also reveal a man who in death commanded a tribute battle that saw more than 200 warriors participate, where most tribute battles at the time, we gather from the sources, involved only about 24 warriors. And finally, the sources show a man who attracted visitors to his grave long after death, a mixed stream of clan members who wept for him and remembered him as, I quote, as you can find in some of these sources, their brother and their friend. Few colonists saw these things back then as evidence of esteem to Bennelong. And historians, I think, too quickly followed suit from how the colonists interpreted those moments. Historians believed with the early colonists that Bennelong's absence from Sydney Cove in his later life must indicate loss of some kind. Even as, you know, as the decades rolled on, I think historians were keen to switch blame for that loss onto the colonists themselves, but loss is still the theme that prevails. They didn't read his absence from the colony as simply proof of a presence elsewhere. So beginning my book this way, beginning with that later life, I hope goes on to colour how we then encounter the more familiar parts of Bennelong's life, unspooled in the preceding chapters. In turn, I hope this challenges the usual implication of the tragic narrative about Bennelong, which is that Aboriginal people ever since him have been and always will be defined by colonial history. I hope it opens up more space for us to see Aboriginal agency on its own terms, and thus Aboriginal futures as more diverse, certainly more possible than has been imagined. Now, Phillip's reputation in Australian popular memory is perhaps as casual as Bennelong's. Both have names that you bump into everywhere in Australia, but neither man has generated a very deep scholarship. Academic historians haven't bothered with Phillip centrally for quite some time. And into the vacuum, a vague sense of Phillip as a benevolent founding father has, I suggest, kind of wafted in. The word enlightenment invariably attaches to him, even more than it attaches to, say, James Cook. The most eminent commentator of recent times on Phillip is probably the Australian barrister Geoffrey Robertson, who calls Phillip, quote, our founding father, an enlightened genius representing humanity, egalitarianism, and moral vision. Now, as a sometime scholar of the Enlightenment, I do have to tell you that I probably had the most fun kind of reversing or upturning that particular characterisation. And I don't in the book deny that Phillip was a man of enlightenment. I do agree that he is. But I do really question the idea that this idea, in Phillip's life anyway, reduced to humanity, egalitarianism and moral vision. Phillip was a man of enlightenment chiefly because he approached every endeavour that he had with a very rationalist mindset, and that's the more important theme in my view. His humanitarianism only went so far as it accommodated a determined colonisation of other people. His notion of equality or equity could never be extended to those whom empire needed to suppress. And his idea of virtue had to find room for shackles, dispossession and forced labour. Furthermore, as chapter one shows in as much detail as I could muster, Phillip was on the reactionary end of 18th century British Enlightenment. When he came home to Britain in 1793, he started immediately badgering the Navy to let him back into a command position. Britain had by then begun its war on the French Revolution, and Phillip was an enthusiastic supporter of the right-wing government that led that attack. In the end, Phillip spent 9 years, one way or another, helping the British war effort against French popular democracy, which is nearly twice as long as he spent being governor of New South Wales. So starting with the end of Philip did at least three things for me. It helped me show his precise kind of enlightenment, which was conservative and pretty limited. It helped me put his governorship of New South Wales into some, I think, unexpected perspective. So it may not have been the most important thing in his life, or even in his kind of last half of his life. In other words, just because Philip might loom large in Australia's account of its penal origins, it doesn't mean that our penal origins loomed particularly large in Philip's account of himself. And finally, this rejigged perspective in turn helped me underscore the global contexts of the establishment of New South Wales, contexts that I think can be lost a little bit by a retrospective settler nationalist lens. Opening with Philip manning the shores of counter-revolutionary England sets the tone for my unfolding portrait of him. A man ensconced in an escalating superpower, driven by what later on we might call anti-liberal ideas, who understood the New South Wales penal outpost as only ever extending or securing Britain's influence in the world. This was a man who would have been horrified by the idea of being known as a founder of a separate country. His hypothetical horror should bring back into focus the global and frankly illiberal circumstances of the settlement's beginnings. So Denning was right that pushing the envelope on conventional history writing can be liberating as well as hopefully useful. I certainly enjoyed this aspect of the project the most, trying to deploy the method to disrupt assumptions, but not kind of pushing it so far that it would be distracting. So it was a fine line. And I already knew that it would not satisfy everybody. And I must admit, there's already been one review that I saw last week that also kind of didn't completely agree that I got the balance right. Which I did think, is this Greg thinking about what will happen when, if you're a young upstart PhD student and you critique your betters, then it's going to come back to you at some point. Anyway, this review, the Newtown Review of Books, generally went through the main points and arguments of my book in a positive way in their own words, so I think that they got the main gist of it. But then the reviewer said, the method, however, does not work. So my reaction was, well, you did get the main gist of the book, so maybe you did. But I understand that, as Greg no doubt understood, experimenting with the form of history is going to open up more challenges than just trying to present a persuasive, convincing argument. So I'll spend less time on my other two themes. The ethno-historical angle, as I earlier called the magical realist angle of history, that's something that really I've pursued in almost all my writings since that master's essay 22 years ago. I often think of Greg's famously blunt way of putting it in one of his books, Readings, Writings. He said, "I cannot cope with an anthropology of natives and a history of strangers. I have ambitions to do an anthro-history of them both," or what he later called an ethno-history of them both. So an anthropology of non-Western cultures, Western cultures always getting history, this natural divide, this convention that he couldn't cope with. And I love it that this convention annoyed him so much that he couldn't even muster the language of critique here. I cannot cope. Turns out the last 20 years, neither could I. My previous book, The Warrior, the Voyager and the Artist, I think pursued that idea of breaking down that convention more overtly than the present one. In that book, I tried deliberately to paint the artist of that book, Joshua Reynolds, to try and kind of depict him through an anthropological gaze, but to return the two indigenous subjects of the book, which was the warrior and the voyage, to the grittiness and the dynamism of history. Inevitably, Reynolds retained a lot of history too, and the indigenous subjects evoked plenty of anthropological discourse. It's almost impossible to kind of get away completely from the way that we now remember these three men. So in the end, I hope that they produced a kind of three-braided ethno-historical study. In Bennelong and Philip, the new book, my effort is more subtle in that realm, but it is still a key feature. Presenting Philip's unconventional marriages, his very homosocial world, his last will and testament, even his birth, as peculiar artifacts of a customary culture, helps break down the convention that Denning couldn't cope with. The convention that says that only some people get to have history, which in turn means that only some people get to be seen as capable of changing over time, including into the future. This is the stakes of what's involved when you make that anthropological and historical kind of divide, the thing that Denny couldn't cope with. And in my case, talking about Philip as a kind of through an anthropological lens was extremely satisfying. In fact, highlighting the exoticism of Philip's life was the only way to rescue this man from, I have to say, rather dull beginnings when I first started probing into the sources on him. On the face of it, he's a pretty taciturn authority figure who does his job properly, has quite boring relationships, and has no grand thoughts. But as a creature of an intensely hierarchical, gender-segregated and wealth-hoarding society, he starts to appear a bit more curious. And he also, I hope, starts to spotlight those aspects that most characterise the world that has been shaped by his society, our world. It was even more important to me to present Bennelong as a man of history, not a man of a timeless land, as Eleanor Dark quite famously called him in her novel from 1941. And look, you know, it's quite easy to critique a novel from 1941, obviously, but it is harder to point out the problems that I think are still current, maybe, that you can maybe identify in some of the more glib kind of evocations of that you find in Australia, of an unchanging culture stretching back 60,000 years. We kind of have the implications and assumptions of that phrase, which does, I understand, try to make a good political point, but as I try and stress in my book, Bennelong's ancestors could only have survived for so long if they had been dynamic, ever-modifying, people who were used to dealing with strangers and with disasters over millennia. My last chapter goes into the tricky issue of Bennelong's own Wongal country, for instance, a country that took up much more space, was much larger in square footage 2,000 years ago due to lower waters at the harbour at that time, but was completely submerged by higher waters, say 7,000 years ago. Right. So throughout the book, I try to show that the Eora, all the clans around the Sydney Harbour, understood their past as being embodied in country and vice versa. But because country changed in shape and in form so much, this should also be a sign to us of a much more complex Aboriginal understanding of history than we usually grant. At the kind of more particular individual level as well, I wanted to convey that Bennelong was an historical actor more than he was just a representative of a culture. And by that I mean that he himself changed over time. It's arguable indeed that Bennelong changed his mode or practice over the course of his adult life more than did Philip. I argue that while the constant of Bennelong's life was a determination to protect the Eora as best he could, he changed his ideas about the best strategy to do that over his adult life, where he spent a good 5 or 6 years believing that engagement with the newcomers was the best route to take, to engage in what newcomers like to call conciliation, what we perhaps settlers like to call these days reconciliation. Bennelong later felt that turning back to his own people, away from engagement, might be the more productive thing to do for that moment in time. And as an aside, I might say that watching the Indigenous journalist Isabella Higgins last Sunday on, I think, Insiders, after she was asked her reflections about Indigenous leadership after the failed referendum, when she said that there might be a turning away from engagement, a turning away from reconciliation, and are now kind of more look towards their own, it was a pretty uncanny moment for me. We should expect our Indigenous leaders to change their minds about how best to achieve their goals in their own lifetimes, and Bennelong certainly did. Most leaders in history do. My final theme tonight is the theme of comparative analysis, or work that combines two worlds. Denning himself often called it encounter history, or history that looked at both sides of the beach. And the title of my book plainly would suggest that it is encounter history in a nutshell. But actually, this is probably the bit where I diverge from Denning the most. I was for a long time inspired by the idea of encounter history. It's kind of twofold nature, it's kind of dualism, it invites lots of exciting work, as Denning himself exemplified. And I have written many shorter pieces in history in that encounter history mode, and in some tribute to Denning's work that included, you know, looking at the English arrival in Tahiti, or the Vancouver exhibition in Hawaii, or the bounty ship in Pitcairn, or even, most famously, the death of Captain Cook. But over the years, I began to think that both sides of the beach history has some problems as well. It may well elevate the Indigenous perspective from a former low base, but that perspective is never going to be more than half the story. Also, by centering contact itself as the central driver behind encounter history, one does implicitly center the force that always initiated contact, which is always empire. So in my last two books, I wanted to think about how you might write a history which acknowledged the imperial intrusion into Indigenous lands, but did not have imperial intrusion take up all of the limelight of that history, or rather did not have imperial intrusion set the terms for that history. This seemed important to me if we were ever to understand how encounter truly feels from the Indigenous side of the beach. It seemed important to find a way to go beyond just having Indigenous people be co-stars with imperialists in imperial history. How could they be, in fact, the main characters? And what I found worked best was biography. To trace the full lives of people who experience encounter is to place contact itself in fresher and larger contexts. I think this is what my accounting of Bennelong's full life does. By tracing the full 50 years of his existence, or kind of unraveling the full 50 years of his existence, we get to see a man shaped by Indigenous culture, who meets with a hugely momentous and unexpected force when he was a young man, but never becomes wholly defined by it. A man who engages with that kind of momentous, unexpected force for a short while, but then goes back to what was always the most likely fate for him, immersion in his Eora society. Such an accounting has to diminish empire in this story, even while it acknowledges the enormous effect of empire. And strangely enough, tracing the full life of Arthur Phillip did almost the opposite work. By narrating the full 75 years of Phillip's life, 40 of which were spent in loyal service to the British Empire around the world, we see imperialism become much more significant than it has been in common tales about our founding father. Possibly, as for Bennelong, the 5 or 6 years or so working to settle New South Wales were not quite as key for Phillip as later histories have implied, but situating those 5 or 6 years among a very long career of devotion to empire's spread, and that included Phillip being in North America and South America and in Europe and a couple of times in India, if we set those 5 or 6 years of New South Wales against that long career, it makes us see more clearly that the settler side of this encounter was much, much bigger than a fleet of convicts set out to build a new society. The settler side of the beach in this scenario indicated an empire that had aspirations of being nothing short of the world's first superpower. So comparative history, ethnohistory, experimental history, these were what Greg did best to my mind. And they've inspired me for most of my career and marked most of the pages of my newest book. I have naturally thought about Greg a bit this week. I have thought about what he, as a former Jesuit priest, might have made of recent decisions at the Australian Catholic University. I have thought about what he might have made of the recently defeated referendum for an Indigenous voice to Parliament. To people like me anyway, I suspect he might have said, "We saw that you were sad, but hoped you would get better soon." Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kate.
Now you might need the... Oh, you don't have a mic.
Matthew's got it. We do have a bit of time for questions and discussion. So Matthew has a roving microphone. If you want to just put up your hand, we'll deliver the mic to you, and we'd love to hear questions or reflections on Kate's talk.
Thank you. Thank you, Kate. That was a really great lecture. And I love your book. I've read it, and I disagree with the reviewer whose name I don't know at the Newtown Review of Books. They're wrong. It's a success, and your method is a big part of that. I think that you shine light on new parts from a new angle, you know, the bits around the back that people don't want you to see, and surely that's the point of new writing. But my question is... You must have thought many times in the course of writing this book, am I mad? You know, like, what am I doing? You know, I'm doing this so the hard way, you know. I want to know what kept you on with the determination to see it all the way through to print in this format, because I know you would have had those moments.
Yeah, that's true, yes. Yes, well, I did have quite a few discussions with some colleagues before I began, saying, would this be mad? I actually do remember in Toowoomba when we were giving a panel together, actually. I talked to Tim Rouse about it, which if any historians in the room will know that he's a pretty frank-speaking kind of historian. So I said, do you think this is a crazy idea? And he said, I think that sounds really interesting. And we both, neither of us together could think of a history that did it. But I knew a couple of novels that did it, and he knew of more novels that did it. And he said, you should go and read Martin Amis's Time's Arrow, which some of you may know of. And I was a big fan of Martin Amis, am a big fan of Martin Amis, but I hadn't read that book, which begins, if people here have read it, I'll remind you, it begins with a man in the bathroom where his lunch goes back up through his body and out his mouth. I was thinking, oh, this is a terrible idea. This is what Tim Rouse was sort of more subtly telling me. This is like deathly stupid idea. But actually, that book, when I tried to state, why is this novel so bad and why do I hate it so much? It's because time itself moves backwards in this book, and that is a whole other type of experiment which I did not want to achieve. So it made me realise that what I was doing in the book, I was plotting events in a reverse order, which is slightly different from making time move backwards. So once I kind of realised that, I had a really fun time writing the first draft. It was not as difficult as I thought it would be. I kind of said to myself, you know, I'll write one or two chapters. If it looks really stupid and doesn't seem to work, I'll stop it. But I just kept on going, and I really enjoyed it. But then I did give it to my editor, who then said, well, because it's, you know, events in reverse order, therefore there is, of course, some forward motion in each event, right? So it kind of moves that way, rather than time itself reversing. And every single little event then implies a decision that you have made. And I wasn't as fully aware, as my editor repeatedly told me, of every single tiny micro decision that I'd been making. I said, oh, I just made the decisions that would just be natural to the reader. And he did show me, and the editing process, even though the first draft was really fun, the second draft was quite difficult because I had to be made much more aware of all the little micro decisions that I made along the way about when do we, you know, we talk about a scene moving forwards, but then the next scene is the day before. So, I was always very committed to the idea that I hoped it would be intriguing, disrupting, interesting, not distracting, annoying, make you want to close the book. And so, yeah. So the second draft was tricky, but yeah, I'm glad I got my Martin Amis anecdote in. I was trying to think about ways of explaining why that book was so horrible. Anyway, sorry, Martin Amis fans.
Other people. Joy.
I like making Matthew. Thanks, Kate. That was fantastic. Congratulations. Great lecture. So my question is, so that methodology you've described, do you see it specific to this project only to kind of enhance your argument to strengthen what you want to say, or are you now thinking, reflecting? No. And if it's that, what specifically do you see it has enhanced, you know?
That's a really good question. And I think when my editor was trying to kind of make me more aware of the nature of the method, and then, you know, there is a bit of a defence of the method in the beginning, just I try to make it kind of brief-ish. I felt like he was maybe pushing me to make a defence that we all historians should only ever write histories backwards, and this is definitely not what I wanted to do. I thought it just was, as I've talked about, appropriate for this particular subject, two men who together I really wanted to almost turn inside out in terms of our memory of them and the reputation that they both have. But there was an extra little part of the defence in the book, which I haven't talked about here, which is that I was inspired by some recent historians talking about how we might still think about, you know, I mean, Denning was interested in all sorts of types of experiments, but is there an experiment that actually challenges some of the problems of the Western aspects of history itself, the colonial aspects of history itself? And I was particularly inspired by someone who I actually studied with at Berkeley, who wrote a quite beautiful book called Time's Monster recently. And her book, written from the perspective of of colonial India, really talks about how what we might, or some of us in the room might call Whiggish history, but kind of a progressive sense that history always just opens up that more and more freedom, that history, that the world always moves towards more and more freedom, what some of us call Whiggish history or progressive sense of history. Perhaps when it's talking about empire, has implicit within it a justification for violence, because it always has the suggestion that the means will inevitably always justify the ends. I mean, the ends will always justify the means that we get there. You know, so in the instance of colonial India, there's violence, there's massacres, but in the end, we get railways and democracy. So there's always, and then the histories that then tell that story perhaps implicitly have within it, certain political connotations which maybe historians haven't been as aware of as they might be. And I thought that actually, I do think that the forwards momentum that we normally narrate our stories through might be part of that. And even if it's not, even if I could just spend one book thinking in a different way about the ordering of time, would it make us think in a much larger way, have a much larger conversation about our own discipline of history and what is it kind of wrapping up as justifiable means towards an end that we don't necessarily critique as much. So that was sort of the, it was going on in my mind a lot. I think in the book it only comes to a few paragraphs, but yeah.
Thanks. Thanks, Kate. I love your project, as you know. And I guess this is another methodological question following on from this, you know, this fantastic project of writing backwards in time. And that is about, you know, despite all your reservations that you articulated about encounter history, you know, you're writing a history about, very famous history about contact or overlapping worlds where only the very small part of these men's lives is involved in that contact. So, you know, they are apart, they come together briefly, they move apart again, backwards in time. Could you say more about how you navigated and the challenges of navigating that kind of dance between a contact story that's mostly spent apart?
Yep. That's right. So, I mean, one of the problems with pairing them, of course, is that one man lives for 50 years and one man lives for 75. So it's already kind of a slightly uneven pairing. But I was very aware that one of my main points is that the 5 or 6 years of them being together is not the most defining aspect of either man's life. And that might tell us something interesting about the nation that does think it is the most defining aspects of their life. But then, of course, you can't just like skip over it. Proportionately, I couldn't just make New South Wales a tiny bit because no one would buy the book. So there's a balance. So New South Wales, of course, does take up, you know, a good chunk, maybe half, I would have to say, even though the implicit argument is This is not necessarily the most interesting thing about them, but if we can see the other aspects of their life, we might be able to read that initial period of contact, the famous period of contact, the first 5 years of settlement, in slightly fresher ways. And if that's enough of what I did, then I'd be happy. But it does speak a little bit as well to talking about what I mentioned last, of writing the full lives of both men, and I really wanted to include, you know, birth stories, childhood stories, maturation stories, last public acts of service. What does a retirement look like for both men? What does the immediate posthumous period for each man look like? These are all aspects for when it comes to those two guys, just skimmed over it always in a few sentences. And if we saw them instead as interesting histories in their own right, would it reflect slightly differently on what we know of New South Wales in the first 5 years?
Yeah. Just a question about contradistinction. So when you're writing a history like this, you have an enormous weight of history on you, right? Because the Enlightenment, to start with, the documents that sit there, the archives, there's so much at your fingertips and so much that sits around you as received wisdom about the period. So you're already an insider in one part of the story. How do you manage Bennelong's story then when there's a whole aspect of history and identity that you simply can't engage with? So is Bennelong always in contradistinction by virtue of that to the weight of history, or how did you make a space for Bennelong that was a real and sensible and equitable and defensible space?
Yeah, that's really a really good question, and something that, you know, it's probably not solvable, solved anyway in this particular book, but it's something that I was very aware of. That's a really, really eloquent question. So quite a few times I would kind of try and say things like, this is the full account of Bennelong's life from the public records. Right? Not trying to suggest that there haven't been full accounts in other people's communities that I would not have access to and wouldn't dream of having access to. So that I was kind of hopeful about kind of making that clearer. There are a couple of moments. There was a moment in the chapter on London when I actually do sort of talk to the reader about how, weirdly enough, in these couple of years in London, we actually have more intelligence about what Bennelong is doing than we have about a great white man. Philip is a bit ill when he first comes back. There's not much on him. There's almost a whole year I couldn't find anything on him. But because there's a generation of a production of admittedly British sources about Bennelong, he actually becomes much sharper in detail, where Philip is a bit blurry in this chapter. So, and I tried to kind of bring that out to the reader. So these are sort of slightly unexpected moments in what we think is doable in Indigenous history. Indigenous history has to be so vague and partial and therefore, you know, maybe not even like real history, and that, of course, great white men have endless amounts of sources. It wasn't quite the case, and so I wanted to kind of bring that out. In terms of just talking to Indigenous communities around Sydney, or around, actually, around Australia, who felt a particular attachment to Bennelong, that was really interesting to me. I think there was quite a strong awareness, even in Sydney, but certainly outside of Sydney, that Bennelong is part of a group that is probably even less accessible through memories, just simply for being, having the greatest weight of empire on his peoples. So I did talk to, you know, I mean, already there was quite a long conversation about what collective word I would use. I used Eora in the end. A lot of Aboriginal communities in Sydney would prefer me not to have used that word, because as anyone in Sydney would know, it does literally mean the people. When the colonists go there and say, who are you? And they say, well, we're the people, who are you? So Eora doesn't really mean much. But then there is no collective word necessarily for all the clans, and I needed something to kind of talk about the particular clans quickly. Today there's a preference to call them Darug Nation, but Darug is actually the name of a language, so also in the 18th century that also just wouldn't have been right, but I would have gone along with it because anachronism doesn't, you know, I'm not totally opposed to it. It is a useful term, I think. But then there were other actual Sydney Indigenous peoples who didn't want to use the word Darug either. So I just try and steer the course as neatly as I could. But yeah, I haven't fully answered your question. It was a very alive question that I think is not going to be solved by one book.
Yeah, I wasn't expecting a solution, but
yeah.
Because clearly, structure to methodology is such in tune with the topic, you know, it's extraordinary. So, yeah, I was just
fascinated. Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Maybe I can steal a last question. That's right. I was going to ask something about eclecticism and Greg Denning's legacy and your story about being in graduate school in Berkeley and becoming more critical in some ways of the ideas. It just, my experience of being here and then a PhD at the University of Chicago, which Greg had recommended to me, I realized when I got there, he was thinking entirely of the anthropology department and not history department. But shortly after I was there, he and Donna were there for a whole semester, and he was a visitor in anthropology, which at that stage was racked by very fierce, very articulate arguments between culturalists and structuralists. And it was, at that age, watching Greg in that environment, he kind of had nothing much to say in the face of those very fierce theoretical disputes. He was committed to this kind of generous eclecticism. I've often said to people taking theory and method, an honours theory and method seminar with him as a fourth year student, his most interventionist gesture in a way was at the end of the class where we'd all be exhorted to take home a book or two off his shelf and read any book, didn't matter, come back the next week and talk about what we'd learnt. And I don't know if this is too Pollyanna a sentiment, but maybe as I've grown up more, I think, you know, the more important message he gave was not any of the specific details about ethnohistory or both sides of the beach or whatever, but just that sense that history could be a creative discipline, that we could read and learn from the social sciences and take what we wanted and do what we wanted to do. And I think that's, you know, over the years, that's what I've kind of looked back on. I wonder if you had any similar thoughts.
Yeah, I mean, now I do think, I mean, because he was such a generative, his books have been so generative for me, I do think of it as him standing for a generous and encompassing approach to history. But I do remember that when I did question him on, you know, experimentation may be all right for some, but not necessarily for a doctoral student, which was basically questioning creativity, he was not keen. And he does make a pretty clear that he wasn't necessarily the embodiment of, you know, let a thousand flowers bloom. If it was going to be actually anti a thousand flowers blooming, then he was pretty quick to say that he disagreed. So it was interesting.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to invite our colleague Zoe Laidlaw to move a vote of thanks.
Thanks, David. It's a genuine pleasure to be able to move a vote of thanks. I'll finish appropriately with Kate, but I'll have other people to thank first. Firstly, I should thank David for hosting his event and also for his eloquent remarks about Greg Denning at the start. I'd like to thank Matthew for all the work behind the scenes, plus his very adept movements with the microphone, a great feature of all our public lectures, I should say. Even further behind the scenes, I should thank Leanne Hunt and Jackie Chen from SHAPS and for their administrative support for this evening. And I think I'd like to thank you also for turning out and coming to this wonderful lecture. But the most important thanks of all are for Kate. That was profound, it was disruptive, it's important, and it's an important book at what is obviously an important time. I was just thinking, I just recently read Jane Harrison's novel, The Visitors, where she has, for those of you who don't know it, a group of Eora, for want of a better term, men, sitting, observing the arrival of Philip and the First Fleet and debating what they should do over the course of one long day. And when I read it, I thought, I would love to be able to write this as a historian. I'm not sure that any historian ever could write this. But I think, Kate, what you've been doing here, that effort to foreground, to disrupt, to place Bennelong, especially, in history and to show us why that matters is really important. Thank you very much also for your eloquent lecture this evening.